the No Gimmicks podcast. I'm joined by two special guests. We're going to try to add a little comedy to our wrestling discussions. I got Justin Rupple over here and Alex Mandelberg over here. They are, as I come to find out, comedians and wrestling fans. So that is a very good thing for me because I like laughing and I like watching wrestling. So, Justin, we'll start with you. When did you become a wrestling fan and where are you from, too?
I'm from Seattle, Washington, originally. My grandfather tried to get me into wrestling when I was very young, and it didn't take because he was Armenian and very angry about it, and he would make me watch and use it as parables to this is real life.
Yeah, didn't he? He like bought into the kayfabe. He was like, "This is real.
No, this is this is meant very strong."
Hulk Hogan. He's good man. Iron Sheik, bad. He's very bad. He's from Iran. We are Armenians.
We do not like Iranians.
Iron Sheik is very bad. He's very, very bad. Hulk Hogan. He has shirts, men's shirts. He tears. Is how strong he is. Can you try to tear shirt? And I was like, no, so I couldn't.
But then in college, right before college, when the WCW was right at its peak and fighting back and forth with WWF, and you didn't know on Raw or Nitro or whatever, everybody, anything could happen at any point. Sting would come out from the ceilings, someone would change sides. It was pure pandemonium, and that was wrestling for me. And it was a good time. Goldberg was my favorite wrestler ever. I bought tickets to go see Jesse the Body Ventura speak as the governor. I've performed with Rowdy Roddy before he passed, and
got to perform with have you performed with RVD yet?
Yeah.
I have, yeah.
And
I performed once with Dolph.
Too. Nothing but great. I mean, here's the best part is that all the wrestlers that I've ever had the privilege of meeting are like the most intelligent, socially aware, responsible, hardworking people in show business. And that's more than I can say for the other people I've met in show business who clearly have some things to learn from the WWE. So that's my little story. So, yeah.
Well, when I first met Justin, he had gone away from it completely. Because after the Monday Night Wars ended, once WCW got bought, he went away. He was like, no, this sucked. The one that I liked more was dead. It was dead to him. And me, because I've always been a diehard fan, I always have parties at my house for all the big pay-per-views. And I started forcing him to come. And he would just be so like, nah, what, I'll go. He likes the way I cook, so he's like, I'll come eat the food. I'll eat the food and just hang out.
And then eventually, I came back in with my mutual hatred.
Yeah.
Of Roman Reigns.
Yeah. Yes!
Roman Reigns, my absolute loathing, seething hatred of that gaudy, overacting...
Welcome to the club.
...unoriginal jerk. I was like, you know what? I'm down for anybody who will just beat him mercilessly.
Samoan-vested John Cena.
Yes. Well, I recently had a Facebook discussion on our page about trying to find someone that could find a decent Roman Reigns match. The answers were his opponent was Daniel Bryan for one, AJ Styles for the other. I'm like, all right, next. He's like, give me a Roman Reigns match where it wasn't carried by the best in the world.
You know,
yeah, no kidding, right?
I will give him credit. Last year, the WrestleMania match with Triple H was not a bad match. It certainly was a match that was good enough to call itself a headlining match. But, what was the other... The three matches he put on with Sheamus? Sheamus almost got him over. For like 15 minutes, people were cheering Roman Reigns. I think that has more to do with Sheamus.
Yeah. Again, he's making the point that in order to have a good Roman Reigns match, it's based on
how good the other person is.
I'll put it to you this way. Even screw the match. How about this? Give me a storyline that you like with Roman.
That's the more important thing. The writing around it has been
terrible. Give me something he does out of the ring that you're like, ooh, Roman's on screen.
No. Yeah, nothing.
Never.
But once again, it has more to do with Lana. The way Lana sold that cake dive... That woman deserves a gold star for the way she sold that cake dive. She just picked it up and mashed it right in, pulled the hair back. It was great. That was wonderful. But that's about it. Here's the thing, though. The rest of that segment, that whole wedding thing, terrible. Awful. Just.
I have better facial hair than Roman Reigns.
If they left Roman as the character that he was from The Shield, like this guy who doesn't speak, he just says, believe that, beats up a bunch of people and walks out, that's fine. I enjoyed that character. That's why we all love The Shield. But, no, this whole Samoan John Cena character. It's like, there's a reason we... I love...
Speaking of S.H.I.E.L.D., take off the stupid vest.
Yeah, the vest is just terrible.
Your gut. All right? Do an extra couple sit-ups.
Yeah.
I mean, look.
Well, that's the problem. Like,
he's supposed to be Superman, yeah. And he's holding it in, cinching it in with... You can see him lacing down, like, just gotta put on the vest. I had that turkey dinner last night, yeah.
Well, sorry. I gotta imagine
he's gonna kick my butt someday when he sees.
Yeah, he's like 6'3". I mean, he's not.
I know little. he's huge, but I'm sure he's just.
He's a big, but he is a little big.
I went to the panel when WizardCon came here. And he was the guest.
He was.
So yeah, he was the featured WWE talent that day. So
that's a feature.
It was. It was a bad. It was interesting to sit in there and listen. It was like. But then you kind of get some of the questions that are just like home runs for from the fans that were there. So, but it's just the toughest part was like with him is that's just the thing is like I feel like WWE needs to run the course of everybody boos him, so just make it go that way.
Right.
It's like stop trying to make him the good guy.
Listen to the people.
Yeah. Well, the thing is like Braun Strowman.
Yeah.
Who's going right now is the monster of men.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's like, he's supposed to be a bad guy.
He's right? supposed
and
to
Roman
be.
Roman Reigns is putting him over.
Right. I mean,
that's exactly.
He has beat up Roman without getting a thank you Strowman chant from the crowd. I was there last Monday. As soon as Roman came out and he slammed him, everybody, thank you Strowman. That's the weird thing about it is they keep on booking him against people who they're trying to get heel heat on. And like that, at the very least, you have to realize that he's the worst person to get someone heel heat on. Sami Zayn, opposite story. So over. Everybody loves him.
On that, my wife, not a Sami Zayn fan. There's a work in progress that I don't know if I'm ever going to conquer. It's like me and my co-host Todd is like we continue to try to tell April it is more than just the TV talent that Sami Zayn carries. Because like we know the long history with him behind Ring of Honor and the roots forward that the dude knows how to.
As far as I'm concerned, all you need to know is that jelly leg thing that he does when he gets hit is one of my favorite things to watch in wrestling. When he starts doing the straight leg wobble over and just falls on his face, it's the little things.
It's good selling.
That's there's so many those people who are those next level. Like people really do love them, and they're. Either super over baby faces or those heels that you can't help but cheer. It's those guys who do that extra thing. Like right now, I'm so happy Luke Harper's getting a push. That dude has been so good. He's an older guy, yeah, but to have that much facial hair but still have such facial expressions that I can read, that's not easy. 3/4 of his face is covered in long, scraggly hair. And when he does the eyes and the face and the grabbing the beard... Every time he takes a slam and he does this thing, it's those little things.
Just do for him. It's like my concern is like my favorite current guy going right now is Bray Wyatt. So I was over the top when he finally won the title. But my concern now is that the way that things are headed is we're going to get a triple threat match
for
the Wyatt family at WrestleMania.
It should be that.
And though. Randy Orton completes the turn on Bray by becoming champion at WrestleMania. That's my concern. Because I'm
a good concern, and you can see that's...
Because it's like, man, that puts Bray's title reign at only a couple months. It's like following John Cena's, which was short. It's like, so now we're on a spin cycle with the WWE Championship
Well, the attention span for how long we can take champions is much shorter now.
Absolutely.
If you look at the time reigns, I mean,
the women.
Yeah.
The Raw
Women's Champion is a hot potato. I think no one's going to hold it for more than a month.
I really was like, let Charlotte carry the thing into WrestleMania, and then let the pay-per-view streak end at WrestleMania with Bayley finally winning.
Charlotte's going to break her dad's record in 18 months. She's going to have 17 titles.
Yeah, and they did it again. They did it on Raw. Charlotte lost. It's like, Bayley's now the champion. So I'm like, are we doing the hot potato with Charlotte and Bayley now so that By the time we reach WrestleMania, Charlotte's a six-time champion.
It's kind of the problem, though, is that that's where they sometimes get into that predictability. It's gotten to the point now that if she's defending her belt on Raw, you know she's losing it. She's dropped it in every title defense she's had on television.
Yeah. My thought now is what happens at Fastlane. It's like, is it hot potatoing back the other direction again?
I assume so. Because there's no way, because they keep on talking about Charlotte's undefeated on pay-per-view, there's no way you end that streak
at Fastlane. That's why I was like, her pay-per-view streak's going down to WrestleMania, because that's where the build is going. That's why I just thought you would hold her championship
ring. I think they wanted to break the record, though.
The question would be, is there a direct correlation between how much belts switch and viewership? If it pulls in more people because they know that this week there's going to be a belt change, they have to watch. Instead of, I know Charlotte's going to hold it again on Raw, and it's going to be fine. I can probably not catch this. That's probably the push behind
you're
making it must-see television.
You're absolutely right, but that was kind of... somebody else talked about this. It used to be that if a title defense was happening on TV, that would. You'd get a huge pop in the ratings. It would go through the roof. But nowadays, with how much they've hot-potatoed the title, it's less special. So they're devaluing it by, you know, kind of filling the pool.
So you're saying give it a chance for somebody to hold a reign for a long time to create more.
I just think more faces. I just think it's like for the women's Raw championship, it's like it needs a run. It's like with someone gaining it, just because like right now, it's like I just feel like every time you watch the pay per view, you're like, oh, Charlotte's getting the title back here. Mm-hmm. And then when the title is defended on Raw, you're like, oh, she's going to lose it here.
But here's why that happens, though. Tell me who the top-level belt contenders are in the women's division on Raw. Name all of them.
Bayley, Sasha Banks.
Charlotte.
Oh, and Charlotte, I guess.
That's it. So if you don't have the title bounce around between the three of them, there's nothing else to do because Nia Jax is garbage. Dana Brooke is not as garbage as Nia Jax, but is still smells like garbage.
They are two that came up at the roster split. I don't think that should have come up yet. It's like I think the brand split has hurt the women's division because you have talent on SmackDown too.
The SmackDown women's division, they have six legitimate great workers who could all hold the belt.
Well, maybe that's what they're doing is keeping that over it and building that pile there. And if you have it play runaround on this side, then you can silently develop a better base.
There's no doubt that when Asuka comes up, she'll go to Raw because they desperately need people at the top of the card for the women.
Well, and she's the main attraction from NXT. It's like Raw's their running show.
Yeah. I don't know how Nia Jax could be up and Asuka isn't. That was the chant that I tried to start on Monday when Nia had her squash match. I just kept on chanting, Asuka's better. I got a couple people to join in with me, but...
Well, the tough part is like, that's the thing. Like, Asuka comes up, and where is the NXT women's division is the concern there.
Yeah.
Because that was things like they, at the brand split, like they brought everybody up but Asuka, and now she's floating around. It's like they had to bring Mickie James back to give her some legitimacy at NXT.
I get what you're saying. I really think that that NXT is meant to lose its best people eventually.
It's a minor league.
Yeah, it forces people to elevate. I don't think if we didn't call up Neville and Sami Zayn and all those guys, would Finn Balor have become as much as he became in their absence? Mm-hmm. It's when you scrape the top of it and take the best stuff. Something else is going to rise up.
But I think there's a few that have come up that should have...
I always forget her name, that girl with Sanity. I love her.
Oh, Nikki Cross.
Yeah, I love her. The face, once again, the face work, the attitude, just the always acting like a psychopath. And she'll take bumps to match that attitude, so...
Yeah, I just feel like the brand split brought up some people that should have got a run at NXT to help their profile. Apollo Crews is one, because he's...
Apollo Crews... That's the problem.
Because it's like he's floating in the main roster. He was floating in NXT. Like
because the character is the same as Rich Swann, smiley black man. It does. Like I don't understand why so often WWE won't give a real character to their black roster members. That they're usually just like smile and go out there and be athletic. It's character is what people who love wrestling care about. Justin is always the one who's like, if there's no character, that's why he hates Roman. Mm-hmm. It's why he enjoys...
You have to have a backstory to explain your behavioral patterns.
Yeah.
And if the behavioral pattern isn't inherently visible within just from your intro to the walk to the stage, I mean, I'm disinterested.
You were an Undertaker fan, right?
Of course.
Yeah, like that's
of course
stuff like that's what we care about.
I need the spectacle.
Yeah.
I mean, it was the day and time of coming through the bottom of the ring.
Oh, I mean, God, yeah.
For the love of God, lose your mind.
Yeah.
That's when I loved it. And the more that comes back, the mm-hmm. better. And
Yeah, one of my buddies that is a YouTube guy, Brian Zane from Wrestling with Regret, was bringing, because he got asked the question of, does WWE need more of the gimmick type characters as opposed to the more realistic that you have now? It's like, it should be 50-50, and he feels like right now it's kind of like 70-30.
Mm. In which way do you think?
It's like more realistic, real. Yeah. Like more real people being real as opposed to just the gimmick character, because... Like Bray Wyatt's a gimmick character, right. But that's close. Like, but that's the thing.
But
like,
super over.
Oh yeah,
super. Finn Balor is 50-50 because of the demon thing. Super over. Those gimmick guys. Here's the thing. The problem with the super gimmick guys is they either pop huge, or they just die immediately. So you have to take more shots to find stuff that sticks. But. In the end of the day, those are the characters we remember.
If I'm wrong, even the more real guys started gimmicky. I mean, look at The Rock and Cena. I mean, both of those guys, Cena started out as straight up hip hop.
He had the chain around the neck.
I mean, yeah. The albums and mm-hmm. I mean, you couldn't go 30 minutes without a little rap lyric from him. Look at I'm sorry for my memory. The Rock's original name.
Oh,
Rocky Maivia.
When he had that big flat top
the arm thing and stuff. Yeah. In order to get the realness, he had to understand the depth of the giant character. I mean, you're wearing the biggest giant character of all times t-shirt. I mean,
yeah. People would consider like, oh, that's a realistic, and it's like, it was still a gimmick.
And the gimmick was, he was so over the top. I mean,
we're blessed and off into the atmosphere. Yeah,
you assumed he was out of his mind, mm-hmm. and you would assume correctly.
he was,
but he's the most impersonated. Probably one of the most impersonated people next to Christopher Walken. I mean, everybody I know has a Randy Macho Man.
That was the thing. Like Macho Man left the wrestling world. He was one of the obviously Hogan did too. He's like. Those two are probably from that era that transcended just wrestling. It's like everybody knew who they were.
But to make the point there is that they were over the top. They had a gimmick, and then they became real. You know, and that's what we wanted. Yeah. We want you to start ridiculous and then look behind the curtain to see the realness. Mm-hmm. And that's what elevates. That's why WWE, WWF for over 40 years or 30 years has been. The reason why we get the biggest celebrities. I mean, Hulk and Rock and Cena and Macho Man every great celebrity goes on there because of the characterness, and they play themselves.
Yeah.
They all play themselves.
Yep. I think that's why Bayley's getting so over right now is because she found a way to turn what John Cena does into a gimmick. And instead of just kind of being the real smile in the face, aw shucks, turn that into something super gimmicky. I'm a hugger. I'm always happy. It's all, like, even though it's stupid and a lot of the older fans might not love it, you go, it's a gimmick and it's fun.
And when you see the dads in the audience who are like, this reminds me of the days when I was your age, you know, because the dads are now my age, right? You know, mid-30s, you know, and they're bringing their kids out and they're like, see, I needed it to be a little bit more like it was. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, yes, gimmicks. Gimmicks are important, is what we're saying.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, going off of, you had mentioned that Goldberg is your guy. Mm-hmm. Obviously, he is back.
He is.
And one of the things that bugs me a little bit is that I have the feeling he's beating Kevin Owens at the upcoming Fastlane and carrying the Universal Championship into WrestleMania with his to me, lost feud with Brock Lesnar now, because I just don't quite understand how Goldberg is free to accept a match with Brock Lesnar when he beat him in minute 26 and then eliminated him from the Royal Rumble. It's like, what does Brock or Goldberg have to gain right now from another match with Brock Lesnar? I thought he should have either been eliminated at the Royal Rumble by him, or Brock Lesnar needs to be in this position with Kevin Owens.
Correct.
It's like to carry the belt into WrestleMania, and then Goldberg's chasing Lesnar at WrestleMania.
It's the juxtaposition of those two guys. I mean, I think it's just clearly when you put Lesnar and Goldberg in the ring together, the aesthetics of those two is fantastic. I mean, they're both beast men.
Yeah, it looks good on camera.
And when you put Lesnar or Goldberg individually with anyone else in the ring, you automatically, David and Goliath, go, I know who the. But the two of them together, even though the eliminations happen, even though you're like, I still don't know. Because it's the Battle of Titans.
And here's the... there's a lot of things about the way Goldberg has beaten Lesnar up that is good, because we all know that Lesnar's going to be around in wrestling a lot longer than Goldberg is. Goldberg probably only has a couple of months
45,
left. 46? Yes.
Yeah.
He's up there, and Lesnar's still, probably a couple years left.
Yeah, but we said that about Undertaker.
Yeah!
Now Undertaker's... He knows an Undertaker now.
Yeah, no, that's true. And Goldberg is certainly in much better shape than Undertaker probably ever was.
Yeah. Well, he's also not 6'10"?
Yeah, no.
I mean, those can't be his knees anymore.
He recently just had hip surgery. So
there's not even his hips anymore.
No.
He's the Terminator.
Yeah, no, he is
the undead.
Well, and he is plastic from the waist down.
It's like, and now he's going to, I believe, is like, if, like, the road travels us down, I think he's showing up Fastlane to cause Roman Reigns.
Yeah, cause
lost.
Roman, yeah.
It's like, and that's the thing. It's like, we're going to have Reigns and Undertaker, and you got the aged Undertaker trying to carry Roman Reigns. It's like, I don't know how well that's going to play out.
No,
plus, again, it's like, we're still on the feeling that WWE wants Roman to be a face. It was like, well, it's completely gone at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Completely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're not going to boo Undertaker and cheer Roman. And if they have Roman put another loss on his tick, I mean, that's going to be the worst heel heat in the history of all time.
So unless that's the moment when they decide this is when we're pulling the trigger, he's now a bad guy.
Yeah.
He wins dirty.
Yeah,
he is going to win dirty against the Undertaker.
I would like that.
Undertaker's already Hall of Fame. I mean, we talked about it during the Rumble. I mean, it's like he doesn't have to prove anything. So you can turn him finally, as they should, because I hate Reigns, and everybody loves to hate Reigns.
Yeah, and so let us hate him.
And then if you just did that, again, that's one of the frustrations that brought me in. I was like, I want to be here when that piece of poo
becomes a heel.
I want to see it, because I will buy all the heel shirts in that point.
Yeah, but what I was saying about Brock Lesnar, and the reason I was happy he got squashed is, if 3 years from now, with the way they've been billing in the last 2 years, we're just walking through everybody, he couldn't have a match with Finn Balor that Finn could realistically win. Now the way he's taken losses to Goldberg,
he can lose.
There's a chink in the armor, you go, oh, Brock's beatable.
Yeah.
He can lose.
Yes, but Brock's beatable by, to your point, Brock's beatable by Goldberg.
Yeah.
So Finn Balor coming in, you're like, well, how is Finn Balor going to...
Finn's a tiny guy.
I get it. Well, it's like my also other thought is, we know that Kevin Owens can go, but my concern is like, if they have Goldberg and Owens do anything remotely close to some type of match, it's like, doesn't that hurt what happened at Survivor Series? It's like, or are they still just trying to sell that was just a complete shock and Lesnar was caught by surprise?
Because they sold the broken rib and all of that stuff. I'd be very surprised if they have Goldberg squash Kevin Owens. That would surprise me. I think we're going to see something resembling a match.
Yeah, but it will be broken up. There won't be a decider. It will be a good storyline that'll be interject. I don't think you can have him do that.
I'd be very surprised if Goldberg... I mean, I have the same fear as you of Goldberg carrying the belt into Mania. I don't think that's going to happen, but... I hope it's not going to happen. My prediction is
they didn't let Undertaker win. I mean, they didn't let him pick it back up, so maybe they know what they're doing. They're not going to make it.
But the thing is, you know Owens-Jericho is happening at Mania. If they're both holding belts, that kind of kills the mid-card and top-card all at the same time. You're not going to unify the belts, are you?
That's why my thought is like Goldberg is taking it from Owens, like, and then
Owens and Jericho for the U.S.
Yep. But that's the thing. It's like, and then Owens immediately has a title right around with his waist again. It's like WWE loves him having a strap. Like,
he should.
It almost feels like since day one he's had a belt around his waist. Like,
because he should look. I mean, the type of character he is works better with a belt.
Mm-hmm.
There's some guys who don't need it, like Sami Zayn. You can wait a while till he gets a belt, because when he does, it's going to be a huge pop, and he can lose it a month later.
People who are better with the belt those are the people who have a better cock in the walk when they're carrying the championship. They have a better swagger.
Yeah.
And it makes that
cocky stuff believable because they have the proof.
Then they can say and call out people, and it's a better match than it is. Because that guy without a belt, you don't want him as an underdog. And, you know, that's the point, is that you like cheering against in that point. So
heels hold belts for long times better. Belts die around faces' waists if they stay there too. That's why the SmackDown Tag Division is buried. They just let American Alpha bury the whole division. And there's a lot of good workers there. I think Breeze Danko should have been given a real push a long time ago.
They're workers, but the problem is like they've been now so buried in a gimmick that is lost.
This is why they're so good, though. They do so much good stuff with such a bad gimmick. When Fandango had the tickets tucked into his band, and he dropped the guy and then started dropping tickets on him, and he'd written things on the ticket. Terrible pants, your makeup is all, like, all of that stuff. That's a great work with a terrible gimmick. And those guys have been killing it with that awful gimmick. To the point that now I like the gimmick. I like the fashion police. I'm like, yeah, cool, great.
Now it appears like they're fashion...
Popo.
Was like, but they look like they're... like naval now.
Yeah, a little bit. They're getting a little bit military.
Yeah.
A little bit militaristic.
With the blue camouflage.
A little bit. Well, they got the bars on the chest.
Yeah, they're wearing the white with the bars now. Yeah. So.
Yes, well, it is very, it's very chic.
I love everything.
Boards are back in, and what the guys say, you know, shoulder pads are making a comeback.
Oh, God, I love those two guys. I really do. I love them.
But I do like what... it looks like we're headed towards with the SmackDown Tag Division and seeing finally getting Usos and American Alpha to work the front. I don't know. I like it.
They've already buried them twice. American Alpha's already beat the Usos twice and quickly. As far as I'm concerned, if the Revival are not called up next week for a Revival against American Alpha match at WrestleMania that Revival wins, the SmackDown Tag Division's done. It's just done. Evil Usos.
It's like I completely agree. It's like they have sunk in most of the tag, if not all of it, because I thought at the last pay-per-view, it was like Uso should have been last, not the Ascension.
Poor Ascension.
It's like another team that basically was thriving on NXT, buried on the main roster. It's like, and now I don't know if they can.
They held the tag belt in NXT for what, 360 some odd days?
Longest reign.
They have not won a match on the main roster in over a year.
Well, they won the one. They won the match that got them to come out last.
That's right.
That was it. And I loved the mask that Connor had on at the pay-per-view, and I had known it was coming because he shared a tweet on Twitter from the designer, and I was like, all right, cool, love the mask, don't understand quite so much how well it's going to come off on a team that no one cares about. It's like, so like, then it seemed like
you should wear a mask over your head and it could be a paper bag
So it's like, well, then it felt like they were starting to try to build him up, and I was like, okay, it's like maybe they'll slow build him back up to WrestleMania, and at WrestleMania he'll bust out the mask. busts it out at the end of the gauntlet and they lose. And I was like, all right, now it's lost.
Now no one cares about the mask.
So
could be the coolest mask in the world. Meanwhile, I wouldn't know because it's on the
designer's like, come on! How many hours?
Oh, I didn't realize it was Connor from Ascension. Why did I take that job?
Yes. So I was like, well, off, I was like switching a little bit because I think we've covered a lot. Mm-hmm. I want to get a little bit of some of your impersonations because you're the impersonation master. And
yeah.
I know I asked if you had any.
I have a few.
In the bag.
I have a few.
Well, I was like, let's start. I was like, if we can, because I heard a little bit about. You do a good rock, it's like, and there's kind of a reason why they have connected. I know you can't officially say where it comes from, but there's a connection to it.
I've always loved Dwayne Johnson, and the in and around impressions, you're trying to figure out who is the most prevalent person to do, and he crawled out and is still in WWE, and for voiceover purposes, I got an opportunity to kind of mimic his
voice. You had done it on First Impressions, too.
Yeah, I did it on First Impressions, yeah.
When you were on First Impressions, you were like, oh, it's on USA,
right.
Wrestling's on USA.
Right, and so to give the fun behind it, anytime you do an impression, you try to figure out how they sound, and The Rock clearly had gotten over an accent problem in his early life. And when you get over an accent problem and you're trying to sound Western and you're trying to sound TV diction, you over-enunciate everything. And so that's like part of how you do The Rock, is you have to over-enunciate everything so that there isn't a chance for a Samoan accent to slip in. And then on top of that, you have to kind of make your chest and sides big enough to play.
And your throat and your...
To play The Rock, yeah. And so in order to do his impression, I literally have to, Alex, I like that shirt. You know what list you're on? The list of people who I'm going to kick their ass, brother. Yeah, like this. Watch out, jabroni. Do you have another shirt? It doesn't matter how many shirts you have. And I've always done the eyebrow anyway. Except it started with John Belushi when my dad, when I was younger... And it doesn't matter which one. The people's, I believe the people's eyebrow is his right eyebrow.
Yeah, the people's eyebrow.
The people's eyebrow is his right. And then Belushi's was his left. Maybe your dance finger. Yeah. And so that's The Rock. And anything The Rock tells you is just going to be... Where would you want to hear The Rock?
I just realized everything with Rock was pretty much the right. Because the people's elbow was the right elbow as well.
Yeah.
Was always there.
It's the correct album.
It's the right.
It's the correct.
It's the right.
And then the other ones I did when I was in college, I saw Jesse the Body Ventura a lot in speaking roles and everything because I was super into conspiracy theories and so was he. And I would love the way he would rap in conspiracy theories that made no sense. You know what I mean? He'd be like, let me tell you a little bit about what's going on with our water. Now you understand... Water makes up a large part of the earth. And who's in control of the water? Think about it. Now, they're putting fluoride in the water, and we're getting dumber. Coincidence? I think not. I was the governor of the state of Minnesota. I was a Navy SEAL. We drank water out of a hose. I won't drink it out of a hose now. I won't. It's horrible. And the people should know... What's in their water? Just gonna say it out loud.
That's a good Jesse. That's a good old Jesse, the Body Ventura.
Well, of course, young Jesse, I can't do.
That was when he actually had a voice.
Yeah,
before he'd blown that whole thing out. You don't want to do a young Jesse the Body Ventura because we'll get kicked out of our hotel because you can hear it five rooms down. He just screamed.
Well, and then for fun, Alex and I wanted to demonstrate dueling Macho Man. If that's okay.
If you want to sit here and tell me, here, brother, that you do a better Macho Man Randy Savage.
Do you understand how much better I do a Macho Man than you?
We will blast into
the atmosphere. You don't turn around.
The atmosphere, you're macho doesn't man. Understand
what you're talking
when
about.
When we are bring in space,
bring
rotating
in.
Around the times.
You need a Slim Jim, and I will
I'll bite into that Slim Jim.
I will break your face.
And now I can't do it.
Mine is more of a younger one, I feel like. You get more of that older one. You do bone saw. I do macho, man.
I do. Bone saw's ready.
Come on, I'm always going to sound like
Yeah, you're.
So, what do we got in the future of Justin Rupple?
A lot of touring this the next couple months, trying to get back out on the road, go to Wisconsin, Washington, other states. A lot of ins and outs, man. The do the binds. And then little projects I can't talk about for NDA reasons. Keep your eyes peeled, I guess.
Social media.
Social media is The Rupple. That's my last name. Rupple. It's like Ripple with a U. All of them. The Rupple. What? His is the
Mine is A. Mandelberg. It's
was
terrible.
It used to be a funny Jew, right?
No, Mitch made me one and he gave it to me and I just have never used it. I'm not on I don't social media as much as I should.
You have a wrestling podcast yourself, so
I do. We're premiering next month. It's called the Wrestling Podcast Federation, WPF, and it's me and a comedian from Maryland originally. His name's Tiff Myers, really really funny guy, and we review Raw, SmackDown, and pay-per-views, and we, talk about future stories and what we like and what we don't like and what we wish they'd do and storylines that we wish had happened and stuff like that.
That's a great pod. I've sat and listened. They're great. You do a great one here, too. But clearly, you guys know. This was like watching two savants talk about wrestling. And I'm on the outside, like, watching, like, you know, like, Double Dutch, and I'm like, Can I jump in? I'm in.
Well, it's a new thing now to get to be a smart wrestling fan. I feel like Xavier Woods deserves a lot of credit for letting us, because he's given some great defenses of it, and I now use a lot of his defenses. People are like, you like wrestling? Like, it's the last bastion of theater in the round, Shakespearean, serialized stories that go on forever and involve a live-action stunt show. And where else do you get live theater in the round anymore, except for wrestling?
What I appreciated is the fact that the WWE allowed their wrestlers over the last decade to break character outside.
Yes.
And when that started happening, when you started seeing, who used to come on The Daily Show all the time?
Seth Rollins?
He
did a couple
of them. Oh my God, bearded, cross-eyed, sleeveless flannel.
Oh, Mick Foley.
Foley. Mick Foley kind of led that and broke his children's books and so forth. And then when you started to see that these people were playing characters and then they're that good of actors, that helped bring people back instead of making them dress up.
Yeah.
Macho Man used to go on.
Yeah, if he showed up anywhere, it was as Macho Man.
And when now you're seeing them allow them to take roles and break character and talk about their character, it's so much more intriguing.
And these guys also now, with all this, having their own podcast. Like, I love Chris Jericho's podcast, but especially because he's not in kayfabe in there. He'll talk about the matches and he'll talk about bumps they took. Hearing him talk about the match he had with Ambrose where he took the tack bump. And just everything that was going on in his mind. You never got that in the 80s and 90s and even early 2000s. That's a very new thing. I feel like Chris is kind of the one who led that with Mick. Being like, no, I'm doing this podcast and I'm not going to be in character there because I'm having music people on as well. And I'm going to have wrestlers on and they're not going to be in character either.
Well, it adds depth to the human being playing the character.
Yeah.
And it means that sometimes you're aware of the fact that this may not be what you think or feel. And that's amazing. It's what makes stars.
Yes, absolutely. So. Knowing that they're not just playing themselves and finding out later on, like, oh, this is really...
That's your talent.
When you hear how soft-spoken Kevin Owens is in his personal life, it makes you appreciate more how big and mean and a-holy he's able to be in the middle of that ring with a mic in his hand.
Well, and what a cuddle bug Dwayne Johnson is.
Yeah, oh,
God. Tooth Fairy movies, and, I mean,
Well, I just, the last interview that we did was AJ Kirsch. He's a fairly well-known guy on the NorCal scene. He won Rock the Promo.
Oh, wow.
As Broseph Joe Brody was the character.
Beautiful.
But he has now worked his connections into the Rock Music, where he was an extra on Ballers.
Awesome. Oh,
very cool. And we got to, he gave us a little bit insight of what it was like to be around Dwayne when the cameras weren't rolling. So it's like, that was kind of cool. Like, he just basically said Dwayne is just a normal guy.
Yeah, normal and generous and inclusive. Him and Conan O'Brien are two of the people I've never heard someone say they won't take a picture. Yeah. Like, he'll always be like,
biggest smile you've ever seen in your life.
Like, too. He'll be walking somewhere late and someone, can I take, yeah, hold on. Yeah, the same thing with Conan O'Brien. He'll be, like, getting into his limo, and someone will be like, Conan, all right, here we go.
I bumped into him on the street one time with a friend of mine who's a pretty decently sized guy. He's like 6'2", 6'3". We turn a corner, and there's the Rock, and Rock just runs into my buddy, and my buddy falls down. Like he's a doll. Rock just, like, picks up, like, oh, my gosh, I'm so sorry, buddy, dusting him off. All that stuff, smiles, like, you're the Rock. Yeah, how you doing? He was going in to record something. Couldn't have, just such a nice guy, always smiling, always shaking hands, a big question asker, which I always say, like, that's a sign of generosity. When someone who knows that I get it, I'm famous, let me ask you questions about you.
Because that makes amazing.
It does.
It feels amazing.
It feels great.
It validates you as a human being.
Yeah.
That somebody big like that, not just size and stature, but gives a hoot about you. It's very nice.
It's a very cool thing. He's a very generous person. So
that's why I'm willing to wear the Seth shirt.
Seth frickin' Rollins is pretty frickin' awesome. So
yeah, it was like, speaking of Rollins, it'll be interesting because he did injure the knee, and they haven't ended hopes of him being at WrestleMania.
He's
obviously
gonna be there. He's gonna be.
So at this point, I was like, I feel like we're locked in. It's like he just ain't wrestling until.
I'm angry at Joe though, because that knee injury was Joe's fault. He put all of his weight put all of his weight sideways. Because when you do that clutch, you're supposed to wrap, take the guy back, have him land on your chest, and roll on the side. And a guy who's coming off a surgically repaired knee, you put it. Joe's a big boy. He's 270. Him putting all of that weight sideways on his knee, it's a miracle that just his MCL tore, which thankfully is the easiest thing to repair.
You're expecting Joe at 270, man, in the middle of fatigue to be like this.
It wasn't fatigue. He just kind of beat him down a little bit. It wasn't a huge spot. It was after like a 2-3 minute beat down, but yeah, I get it.
30 seconds of pretending to do a beat down, and you and I...
Can you give me a bump so I can sell for a little bit? Because I'm tired. I'm gassed. I get it.
So definitely glad that one was in there, just because I didn't want Seth to have to miss two WrestleManias in a row from the knee injury. And they can, and we can finally move on from Triple H and Seth Rollins.
Oh, please. It's been so... They pulled it so long, I don't care about it anymore. That's the worst.
Well, it was... It was a weird thing. It was like on the reattempt to reignite it just came about.
Yeah, he just brought it. Well, listen, Seth, and I love Seth, but it was still the worst face turn of all time, because his turn from a heel to a face was, hey man, you always cheated to help me, and then you cheated to help someone else, man. What the hey? Like, that's his face. His face turn is, why aren't you cheating for me anymore? Which is a weird, that's why he never really fully got over as a face, but it was weird. It was very weird. Much like the Enzo-Rusev feud, where I'm like, wait a second, Enzo's the face, even though he's trying to bang Rusev's wife, and Rusev is like, dude, don't bang my wife, and the crowd's like, no, let him bang your wife, Rusev! What's wrong with you? Boo, Rusev, stopping him! You beat him up when he tried to take your wife to a hotel room?
Meanwhile, Rusev's like, cut. What?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Collect yourselves.
Yeah. It's so weird.
It's a backward story.
It's backwards. Like,
you're not supposed to be cheering for the good guy to steal the girl from the bad guy.
Twice that's happened. That happened with Noam Dar, too. He's supposed to be a heel, and everyone just loves the way he says Alicia Fox.
Yes. Fox!
Oh,
that's the, but that was like, that just, I think, is also another encompassing thing of this nowadays of WWE, is all of the heels are struggle to get the heel
thing. Fully heels.
It's like Chris Jericho created the list and had to ignore putting people on it to become a heel again.
Yeah. There's only two, in my book, true heels, even on the roster anymore, and that's Sheamus and The Miz. People who you never have to worry about, no one's going to cheat.
What are both of them? Extreme characters.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Very
the more true. Charactery and the more sticky you get, the easier it is to be a heel. The more real it gets, the more the conflicted hero.
Yeah.
I mean, the show's Sheamus, like,
ever since he's like, I'm going to just do a mohawk, face piercings, and be a weird pirate Irishman. Boo! Boo, you look stupid. You look stupid.
The,
boo.
But the more our culture is celebrating the tarnished anti-hero and Breaking Bads and, you know, and the Shields and stuff like that, then it's harder to make a real person a full heel.
Yeah.
You have to shtick them up.
Yep.
You know? And that's what I appreciate about, you know, wrestling. So.
Alrighty. Well, we're going, I think, pretty long here.
Yeah,
so,
sorry.
And hey, we could keep going, which
I saw the light a few minutes ago.
So, I think we'll go ahead and we'll wrap it up there. So, this was a No Gimmicks podcast. It's like you can find us on Facebook under the same name and on Twitter at the No Gimmicks PC. So, I thank Justin and I thank Alex for coming on.
Thank you for having us.
It doesn't matter where you can find us.
And hopefully, somewhere down the line, we can do this again.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Thank you.